Well, we've come to the end of Unit 2, so let's just quickly summarize the main topics that we've been discussing in Unit 2, and then we'll be prepared to move on to the next unit. So the main topics that we talked about, well, after a quick review of energy bands, we went to the energy band view of a MOSFET. This is a really important thing for you to understand, because if you understand how MOSFETs function in terms of energy band diagrams, you really know most of the story. We then very quickly reviewed traditional MOSFET IV theory, doing it in a little more detail, the classic square law theory. And we put it all together in something we call the virtual source model, a model that we're going to continue to develop and refine as we proceed throughout this course. So in terms of energy band diagrams, you know, an energy band diagram, the first task when analyzing any device problem or semiconductor problem typically is to draw an energy band diagram. Bands bend when the electrostatic potential is changing with position. The second task is to read the energy band diagram. To read the energy band diagram, if we want the electrostatic potential, we just flip one of the bands upside down. If we want the electric field, we just take the slope of one of the bands. And we recognize that the electron and hole densities depend exponentially on the separation of the Fermi level from the intrinsic level, or the Fermi level from the conduction band, or the Fermi level from the valence band. So we can easily read off qualitatively the hole and electron densities that way. Now, we could also get the space charge density. The Poisson equation says that the slope of the electric field is related to the space charge density. So the electric field is related to the slope of the energy band. We could take a second derivative, or it turns out it's usually easier to deduce what the space charge density is by knowing what the hole and electron concentrations are versus position. And presumably we know how we've doped the semiconductor, so we can put that together and deduce the space charge density. So how transistors operate in terms of energy band diagrams is a very simple story. In the linear regime, we recognize that when we draw the energy band diagram, there is a potential energy barrier for electrons between the source and the drain. That barrier is in the channel. We apply a small voltage to the drain and pull the conduction band and the drain down a little bit. And then the gate voltage, a positive gate voltage, lowers the energy. As we push the barrier down, more and more current flows, and we get the linear regime current. Up here in the saturated regime, that's the regime where the drain voltage is high. We've pulled the conduction band and the drain way down, but the height of the barrier is controlled by the gate voltage in a well-designed transistor, and only leakage current flows unless we apply a positive gate voltage, push the barrier down, and then electrons flow out of the source over the small potential barrier downhill all the way to the drain and out to contact. So this is a very simple but very physical picture of how a transistor operates. So we talked briefly then about how we can understand some things we had discussed in Unit 1 in terms of these energy band diagrams. So for example, when we see the transfer characteristics plotted on a log plot, you know, we remember how to extract Dibble, and Dibble is a reflection of the fact that the threshold voltage is decreasing as the drain voltage increases. So that leads to a translation of the transfer characteristic in the subthreshold regime. You know, we pull that number off and quote it in millivolts per volt of translation. But the physics behind that now we can understand in terms of energy band diagrams. You know, if this is our energy band diagram, zero gate voltage and low drain voltage, there's a large energy barrier. Electrons can't flow from the source across the channel and out the drain. If we apply a large drain voltage and pull the barrier down, the electrons still have a hard time flowing because of the large energy barrier. But if the drain voltage pulls the barrier down a little bit, that helps turn the device on, helps make it easier for electrons to hop over the barrier. Effectively, that lowers the threshold voltage. That's the physics of Dibble. And a transistor designer would want to minimize this effect, would want the drain voltage to pull that barrier down as little as possible. We would like in an ideal transistor for the height of that energy barrier to be fully controlled by the gate voltage and not by the drain voltage. All right, so Dibble physics is easy to understand in terms of energy band diagrams. Well, then we turn to deriving a few equations. So the equations, you know, the physical picture is more easily conveyed by the energy band diagrams, but we want some simple physical equations that tell us the magnitude of the current. We did the linear regime first. You know, we wrote the current as charge times velocity. We wrote the charge as Cox Vg minus Vt. We wrote the velocity as mobility times electric field. We said the electric field is just the voltage across the channel divided by the channel length. We put it all together and we got a very simple but very good description of the linear regime current. Okay, we also looked at the high voltage regime. In the high drain voltage regime, we considered two cases: a long channel device, which behave as square law devices, and a short channel device. In the long channel device, something called velocity pinch-off occurs. The mobile charge goes approximately to zero when we hit the pinch-off point. The current doesn't stop flowing, but it saturates. We write the current the same way, proportional to charge times velocity. We focus on the charge at the beginning of the channel, the so-called virtual source, because we know the charge there. It's Cox Vg minus Vt. The velocity is still mobility times electric field. The electric field we would estimate as the voltage across the channel. Well, the voltage at the pinch-off point is not the drain voltage. It's the pinch-off voltage, Vg minus Vt. It's zero at the other end. So the voltage across the channel is the pinch-off voltage, and minus zero at the source end. Pinch-off voltage is Vg minus Vt. So the average velocity in the channel is minus, it's in the negative direction, Vg minus Vt divided by the length of the channel. But it turns out that the electric field is really nonlinear. We need the electric field at the source where we know the charge. And that turns out to be one half of the average value. Okay. So we've derived our classic square law MOSFET characteristic. Then we took the next step and we actually went through a complete IV derivation so that we could not only do linear regime, saturated regime, we could do the triode regime in between. And we saw how you can get a full description of the IV characteristic that is continuous from linear to saturation. But then we switched to the case that is more descriptive of modern transistors, the so-called velocity saturation case. And what we argued there is that the electric field is very high in these very short channel transistors. Even if the voltage on the drain is small, the channel length is so incredibly short that the electric field is very high. Well, we write the current as charge times velocity. The charge is still minus Cox, Vg minus Vt. But now the velocity, we argue, the electric field is so high, the electric field will saturate at its scattering limited velocity. Okay, now it's even easier to derive the IV characteristic. You put all those together and we get the velocity saturation characteristic, which actually does a good job of describing the IV characteristics of modern transistors. Okay, only one problem. It's based on physics that we know is just wrong. And we know that from detailed numerical simulations and a number of experiments as well that show us that the average velocity of electrons in these small channels can greatly exceed the high field saturation velocity in bulk silicon. And it does that because there just isn't time for electrons to scatter very much and slow down as they zip across the channel and out the drain. So this is an effect that we need to come back to and understand more deeply. But we have developed a two-piece model, and then the next step was to see if we could continuously connect the linear regime to the saturation regime so that we have a smooth model that goes between all regimes. So we developed a way to do that, and the way to do that we called a level zero VS model. And you know, the equations are summarized here. This is a model that you're going to see again and again, and we'll make it a little more sophisticated as we learn more about MOSFET physics. And by the end of the course, we'll have a model that does a very good job of describing the physics and the measured characteristics of modern transistors with very short channel lengths. They're only, one of the attractive features about this model is there are only a few parameters in the model. Most of them have a clear physical significance. Our problem right now is that two of them don't seem to be physically valid, but we will find that they can be reinterpreted in a physically sensible way, and that's something we'll be discussing later. And there's one empirical model that our parameter that we introduced as well in this velocity saturation function. All right, so where we'll end up then as we refine this model is something, a form of the virtual source model that I'll refer to as the MIT virtual source model, because it was developed by a group at MIT. And it provides us with a very good way to describe, a way to understand the physics of small transistors, and a way to analyze measured IV characteristics and extract physically meaningful parameters and understanding from those. What we are going to need to do, though, is to take these two parameters, mobility and saturated velocity, whose physical significance is unclear at the least at the nanoscale, and we're going to argue that they can be replaced by something called an apparent mobility and an injection velocity. And these are not fudge parameters, not fitting parameters, not empirical. They have sound physical basis, and we will be discussing that physical basis when we get to Unit 4. So that pretty much wraps up the topics that we discussed in Unit 2. Now, before we dive into this interesting transport physics, we're going to spend some time in Unit 3 on MOS electrostatics. MOS electrostatics is a really important part of transistor design and operation. MOS electrostatics describes how the voltages that we apply to the terminals affect the height of these energy barriers, and raising and lowering those energy barriers is how we manipulate the current. Properly designed MOSFETs will have something we call electrostatic integrity. They will be designed in a way that the charge at the virtual source, at the top of that energy barrier, obeys this very simple expression. It is mostly controlled by the voltage on the gate with a very weak dependence on the drain voltage through the Dibble parameter. Making that happen requires a good understanding of both one-dimensional and two-dimensional MOS electrostatics. The other thing that we want to do is to understand the charge below threshold. We've assumed in Unit 2 that it was zero, but it is actually non-zero. It varies continuously below to above threshold. Below threshold, it accounts for that important leakage current that we see today. So this whole important topic of MOS electrostatics is something that we will spend some time trying to develop a good sound understanding of in Unit 3.